That was excellent reading, girls. Just great. And you love seeing the young people rise up like that and celebrate Christmas. Merry Christmas. Merry Greedmas, which is the title of the sermon, to help you be just that. And there's outlines in your programs. And anyway, it's just fun. I love the Christmas season. And in case some of you are wondering, you were thinking, oh, the Sunday before Christmas, surely Craig doesn't have another plaid shirt he could wear. I pulled this one out just for you guys at Christmas time. So we're in a series called Paradigm Shift, and in this morning's passage, we'll be looking at Luke 12. But it just seems like we have to read the Christmas story, even if it may or may not have anything to do with this morning's passage that Jesus teaches us. But don't we have to go back and remember who Jesus is in the Christmas season? So actually, we'll be looking, reading some the verses from Luke 2 as a way of introduction this morning. And so turn there first, and we'll be reading verses 4 through 12. And so I just want us to really, it seems like a good way to enter into who is this Jesus that's been talking to us in this series, Paradigm Shift, in the Gospel of Luke. And let's just kind of remember his beginning point of coming to us. So verse 4, "And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn." And a manger, by the way, you know, is just this, it's either a stone or, you know, in our culture, you know, or wooden. And it's something in which is used for a feeding trough, a food box that holds hay or other fodder for larger animals like donkeys and cattle and things like that, sheep. And so they find themselves, because they are a poor couple, they're a newly married couple, and so they in this time, they find themselves in an unusual place to give birth to the baby Jesus in something like this, or like I said, it could be more like a stone within a cave, could be a wooden structure built for the animals, like a stable. "And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger.'" This is our Jesus. So much in just that declaration. Born this day in the city of David. There is the promise in the Old Testament scriptures that through the lineage of David, a king would come who will conquer God's enemy and free God's people. He will be a king with great power and authority, and his kingdom will last forever. We find that baby in this manger. And then it says, a Savior, one that comes and saves us. And we now know not just from oppression of dark rulers of this world, but also spiritual ones too, ultimately the greatest, which is Satan himself, who is Christ, the Lord, and Christ is the Greek word for the Hebrew word Messiah, meaning this is the one anointed. This is the anointed one of the Holy Spirit that would come and save us. And he is the Lord, our Lord. Amen. Born so humbly, poorly, in a manger. Let's pray. So, Father, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to us. And, Lord, he is worthy of palaces and riches. He is worthy in his birth for to have nations come and bow before him and worship him. That day will come. But we are grateful that you sent your only Son to us out of your love for us. Your love for the world, so humbly accessible to anyone who would look to him in faith. And may the world know your love, and that through him and his sacrifice, not just his birth, his sacrifice on a cross, can find eternal life. Thank you. He came not to condemn the world, but through him save us. Amen. Just seemed appropriate. Like I said, it may or may not have anything to do with this morning's passage, but it's Christmas time. Now turn to Luke 12. And what I want us to understand is that if we're going to be set free from the tyranny of greed, if we're going to be set free from the tyranny of greed, our hearts must be rich towards God through giving to others. Very simple, very powerful, and appropriate. God gave us his Son. And so in Luke 12, I want us to... Well, let me read the whole passage before we kind of jump into this. So I'm going to read Luke 12, verses 13 to 21. And let's just kind of read it all together. Not out loud, but let's read this whole passage, and then we'll jump in. Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who made me a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And he told them a parable, saying, "The land of a rich man produced plentifully, and he thought to himself, 'What shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops.' And he said, 'I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.'" In other words, party time. But God said to him, "Fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God." What's interesting, and I've made this point before, is what's interesting to do is when you hear a conversation between Jesus and somebody, and they're talking to him, they're asking him, things are requesting, petitioning him, have you ever paused to think that that's a prayer in these stories in the Gospels about Jesus? For we find someone, unnamed person in the crowd, saying to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." That's a prayer. He's praying. Now, he may not be realizing that this is a prayer to God, but that's what this is. Because Jesus is God. Jesus only says, he says, he only says what the Father gives him to say. And so all these stories of people talking to Jesus are examples of people praying, and we get in on how God would answer that kind of prayer. Now, we have learned, Jesus' disciples asked him to teach them to pray, and he taught them the Lord's Prayer and also to ask, seek, and knock, and it would be given. And so now we find someone asking and seeking something from Jesus. The man's praying, or taught in his talking to Jesus, he for some reason, he feels there's injustice. He may be the second oldest brother, and the oldest brother gets twice as much from the family. Who knows? But he feels, and is it wrong to ask for and seek justice? No. And he's asking, hey, knock, knock, knock. You know, which we knock when we don't have access to something. He's saying, basically, God, give me, you know, I want you to take away from my brother some of that inheritance and give it to me. What's Jesus' answer to that prayer? Hello? What's the answer? No, I'm not answering that prayer. What? But we thought God always answers our prayers when we ask, seek, and knock from him, right? God's not obligated. He looks deeper into the heart. This man is not asking Jesus from a heart that seeks, as we see in Luke 11, God, more of God's Spirit. He's not asking for things of the kingdom. He's just asking from a covetous heart, Jesus says. So like in a prayer, have you ever prayed for something and God gave you a no? Right? Have you ever then, did you hear him speak a little more quietly to your heart about there's a heart issue behind the prayer? Oh man, there is so much nodding going on. I sure like to hear some of those stories. And I could share my own. And so Jesus speaks and answers not just to this man now, but he is included in this. In verse 15, you know, he says, take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. And so this is one of those times the Lord is revealing that there's a wrong attitude behind what sounds like a good request. And Jesus is not here to jump into petty little disputes. He's trying to bring the kingdom. He's trying to bring the Father. He's trying to bring salvation. These are much more important things into the world. And covetousness is, you know, just simply the unquenchable desire to get more and more and more. Just, it's never quite enough, right? And he says, take care, be on your guard. And a really wonderful proverb is Proverbs 4:23. And I want to read it out of the NIV this morning because I think it lines up with that idea of when Jesus said, take care and be on your guard. It's the Proverb 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. In other words, what flows out of our lives is determined by what is stored up in our heart. Make sense? And you have to guard that. Have you ever resolved something in as a follower of Jesus, a disciple, and then it was done with and you never had to guard your heart again on that one? No, this is just the lifestyle of those who are disciples. They have to continually guard their heart against things that want to fill up the heart with junk, with corruption, that would mess it up. So ask yourself, because this man has greed in his heart. He has covetousness in your heart. And so ask yourself, when was the last time you said to yourself, I have enough, I don't need no more? When have you reached that point and you are content, right? All Christians struggle with this desire, just like the world does. And when I ask myself, when have I said I have enough and don't need no more, I It was Sunday, June 21st, 2020. It was one day. And it was Father's Day. And I was feeling magnanimous. And I said to the kids, emailed the family, and said, I don't need anything. You don't have to buy me gifts. I just want your presence here on Father's Day. I thought that was clever. Get it? Their presence being with me, not P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S. They sound the same. And so they did what I requested and only gave me cards. And I have since then written them out of my will. But I did feel like I had that moment, okay? And we all struggle with covetousness, you know? It's just kind of there. And also during this pandemic, I don't know if you followed the story of Lori, is it? I'm always bad with last names, but Laughlin, the actress from Full House, right? And her husband, and the whole scandal with the college admission stuff. And so that actually came to conclusion in August this summer during this pandemic. And I thought, you know, this kind of, there's something in this that captures what's true for all of us. I know that, and this is, like I said, Christians struggle with this, but obviously the world would too. And I know that in my own life, and when I got to college and stuff, that's all I dreamed of, was all the stuff I was going to get once I graduated and got my career going, right, and the nice car and all that. And so I want to just read it from the NBC News release of this, and it says, actress Laura Loughlin was sentenced, and her husband too, you know, and I won't tell all of it, but, you know, months in federal prison and hundreds of hours of community service and hundreds of thousands of dollars, all right? So that was kind of the outcome of that. But then it goes on to say, the Full House actress told U.S. District Court Judge Nathaniel Gorton that she'll redeem myself and use this experience as a catalyst to do good and give back for the rest of my life. And during this, and during the proceedings, the judge had actually said to them, at one point he said, here you are, to her and her husband, here you are, an admired, successful, professional actor with a long-lasting marriage, two apparently healthy, resilient children, more money than you could possibly need, a beautiful home in sunny Southern California, a fairy tale life, as he's looking at her, yet you stand before me a convicted felon, and for what? For inexplicable desire to grasp even more. That's covetousness. But the part of her statement in How Do You Plead, I wanted to save this part because I think it is, if it's possible for her, it's possible for us. And she kind of at one point got teared up, says, wiped her eyes, and seemed to speak off script in her final words to the judge, Your Honor, I'm truly, profoundly, and deeply sorry, she said. I'm ready to face the consequences and make amends. It always begins with confession, doesn't it? Kind of cleans the slate of life, purifies the heart, helps us move forward. And so so this first point was a prayer for more, which I didn't even say, but I wanted us to see that the world and, you know, we can, like this man, ask for more. It's a prayer for more, and God wants to answer all the prayers of his children when they have to do with more of the Spirit in their lives, living out of the power of the Spirit for the benefit of others, and obviously he does a heart check. And so if he says to you or me, the answer is no, and he speaks to the attitude that may be behind the prayer. Let's receive that as children from being disciplined by the Father that loves us, And so this is how our story begins. And so now we move into a proverb, and this is not a proverb, a parable. And this parable, you know, is a parable of a barn full of self. And so that's the second point this morning, a barn full of self. And let's take a look at that now. And he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced plentiful. And he thought to himself, what shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops. And he said, I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I'll store all my grain and my goods. And so a barn in this animated picture is a picture of what a farmer would use to store not just the hay, but also for the animals to be kept. And in the barn, you see, is full and seems to be kind of expanding outward, because this man had so much stuff, so he thought, I need to build a larger one. And what's interesting in this is he says, the man says, I will do this. I will tear down on my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample good laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. In verse 21, when it says, so is the one, who are they? So is they're what? So is the one, they're what? A fool. God said, fool. Jesus turns to you and I at the end of this parable and lets us know we are a fool if we are like the man in the parable. See, that's what I love about parable stories, because Jesus just could have gone, you know, and said, don't be covetous and greedy, all right? Be giving and generous in your heart and stop there. But what do parables do? They invite us into it, and they don't just state things in black and white like the commandments do. And so it makes us wonder. This man is hearing this parable. I wonder if he could hear himself in that story or not. And so they are a fool, and they are foolish in their thinking and their thoughts. And so in this second point of a barn full of self, I think it's good for us to pause and enter into this parable and ask ourselves, what can we learn so that we do not have a fool's thinking? So the first foolish thought has to do with possessions, a fool's possessions. Did you notice that though technically it's not a prayer, who was this man in this parable, this farmer, who was all his talking directed towards? Himself, right? And Jesus is trying for us to understand, and this is something the Jewish audience would be familiar with, is covetousness is a real problem, because it's actually which of the commandments? It's one of the last commandments. It is the last commandment, the 10th commandment. And what's the first commandment in Deuteronomy 5:7? You shall have no other gods before me. And so in our wrestling with a fool's possessions, first we have to begin with the greatest commandment, the first commandment, to love the Lord your God with everything you got, with all your heart. And you shall have no other gods before me. And there are many scholars will talk about how there's an interesting parallel between the first commandment to having no other gods before me and the 10th commandment to not covet. And so in this first commandment, what's being said is, we shall not have a divided heart in our love for God. And an idol, don't just think an object sitting on a mantle or in a temple, but it is anything that draws our heart, our thoughts, our passion away from God. Matter of fact, spiritually, in the New Testament, sometimes it's referred to as adultery. It's like having this love for your spouse, but you say, I also love these others too, and they steal that love away. And so the problem that the first commandment is addressing is one of abundant focus on self in this story. Did you notice how many times the word I shows up? 6 times. He says, I do, I have, I will. And so he has become his own God in his thinking, in what he will do, what he needs, the pursuits of his life. And so in this first point of fool's possession, the first problem is that he is breaking the first commandment, and he has ceased to have no other gods before him. But the 10th commandment begins in Deuteronomy 5:21, and you shall not covet. And so just as the problem of the first commandment corrupts our love for God, the 10th commandment corrupts our love for our neighbor. It means we're being called to not love stuff more than our neighbor. You see, greed corrupts our love for others. And so in this, we can see, again, if we go back to the parable, 4 times we see the word my in here. My crops, my barns, my grain, my goods, mine. You know, the seagulls from Nemo, right? And so Finding Nemo. And so it's just kind of, that's pretty much the only thing I remember from that movie are the seagulls. mine, because I grew up in California and surfed, and it's like, that's what they sound like. And so the point is the problem of covetousness is that it demands more of our time to build bigger barns to contain, which means we are turning people into objects to build bigger barns. We're taking time for that stuff, and we don't have time for others. And so we don't love our neighbor anymore. Our pursuit of more, even when we feel it is justified, is that we end up not loving God or our neighbor. That's the problem. And that's a fool's problem with possessions, is that he thinks he actually owns this. Did this man in this parable at the end really own all that crops and barns? See, one of the beginning points for a Christian is they realize when it comes to possessions, if they're not going to be foolish, is that everything is God's. And didn't Jesus in this parable even tell him when God said, fool, this night is required of you, the things you have prepared, whose will they be? It doesn't get answered, but the implication, whose will it be? Someone else's. Now, you don't have to be rich to have foolish thinking on possessions. But I had that revelation when we bought our first house, and you have that sense of ownership, right? I own this cool old brick house. I own this majestic maple tree in the backyard. It is mine. No, it's mostly the bank's. And we just moved from five years ago, we just moved from that house. And there's since then been 2 more owners. And now there's someone else that says, this is mine. I have arrived, right? And it could just be a car. I remember the first car, my cool car, sports car. This is mine. You could just be in high school and have that sense of, I own this. This defines me, right? But it doesn't. And so it's foolish to think that anything is ours and will not be passed on to someone else. So we throw away the fool's thinking on possession. But the second one is a fool's perspective. And here, in this parable, this man's perspective on life is what? This is what you live for, right here on earth. This is what matters. I live for now, not the future, other than what I can make the now even better for. And so a fool's perspective is lacking that this time in life is just the prelude to the real life, the eternal life that follows. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul kind of addresses this. He says in verse 19, if in Christ we have hope in this life only, in other words, this is it, we are of all people most to be pitied. What are we to be? Pitied because we are fools. Because following Jesus as a disciple, he said, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself right there, man. Hey, you got to give it all to God. You got to give it all to Jesus. It's all his. Deny yourself. Take up your cross. There's going to be hard times. Being a Christian, you know, and following Jesus, Jesus did not have it easy, or his disciples. They all got martyred except for one. They tried to martyr John, but it didn't stick, so they put him on an island in Patmos, you know. And it's like, you got to have a perspective of what? The way I live my life now really matters when this brief moment in eternity is over. So this man got fooled into believing that not only were these possessions, but what you accumulated during that time here on earth is what mattered. The third foolish thing to avoid is a fool's thinking on purpose. So it's not just possessions, it's not just perspective, but it's also purpose. Back in our parable in Luke 12, all good stories have a moral. And Jesus gives us the moral to the story in verse 21. So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. And so in this is we have a purpose, and it's to be rich towards God, not just gather up treasures. It's interesting, you know, it's like this man is laying up for himself all these treasures for who? For himself. Can you hand me my water, please? You can just throw it up here. And so we live our life in a way that is rich towards God. And so the challenge, you know, would be if you suddenly prospered or inherited wealth, what would you do? You suddenly like, whoa, I'm prospering here. Would it be a problem for you? And it can be also of those that have nothing. You know, can poor people also have a covetous heart? Yeah, they could look at the rich person saying, that's what I want. And the rich person's going, what am I going to do with all this? So if you did, what would you recognize it as a gift from God and praise him? Would it start with, you know, I don't know if you ever found that yourself in that position once. Jill and I did once when my mom passed away. She's asleep. I'm going to meet her again. She's not dead. But we inherited money. And so it's like, thank you, God, right? You know. But then the second question would be, would you pray and ask him how he wants you to use that gift that he's entrusted to. It's his. You know, it could be a little, it could be a lot, but do you ask that question and ask him how he would want you to use that? Would you ask the Lord to whom you could give some of it to because they are a person in need? Eugene Peterson, in his book, Tell It Slant, says actually this about this parable. It's kind of neat. He says, greed is a nearly invisible sin, a tiny parasite that makes its home in the intestines of wealth. He goes on then to, which actually is very fitting in this time of COVID-19. He says, and all the time the greed virus is in our bloodstream. Sometimes there are enough scripture antibodies, like commandments, proverbs, parables, which we've just heard all those, to protect us against the infection. But there are other times when our defenses are lowered and our whole system is fatigued. We get the fever and runny nose of greed. It isn't long before we're thinking about building a bigger barn. We quit thinking of wealth as a love to be shared and begin calculating it as a power to be used. So we have to guard our hearts against a fool's possession, perspective on possessions, perspective, and purpose. So now our third point this morning is a barn full of Christ. Now, in the telling of this parable, he will go on from here, in which we won't cover this week, from verses 22 to 34. But it doesn't conclude until verses 33 and 34. So what I want to do is I want to read 21, which talks about treasures, and then read the last two verses of this section, which we will cover in depth more next week. So Jesus says, the one who lays up a treasure for himself is not rich towards God. Then he says, sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure, there's that word again, treasure, in heaven that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys, for where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. Can we say that last verse together, verse 34? Can we speak that out together? Because sometimes there's power when we speak God's word verbally. All right. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So in this, yes, I think it helps hearing the commandments on covetousness. I think hearing Proverbs about guarding your heart are important, and even Jesus' parable, as Eugene Peterson said. But I think there's something important in this, and that's that we have to get the self out of the barn, and the barn is like a metaphor of our heart, our lives, and actually, you can read where it says soul. The soul of who you are is what encompasses everything, and who you are in emotions and the life outside of you, but also spiritually within you. And this is the soul that God created in every man and woman that goes on into eternity. And listen to this, because you know if we replace the word soul, which there is I know of at least one translation that replaces it with self. But listen to him as he talks in verse 19. He says, I will say to myself, self, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. And you see, so we have to take the self out of the heart, because God says this night, yourself is required of you. And we fill it with Christ. So to give is the opposite of what this man was doing in the parable, who was laying up. He was laying up, collecting more for himself. And so we are set free from the tyranny of greed when our hearts are rich towards God through the giving to others. Blessed are the poor, Jesus says in Luke 6:20. And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Now that works on two levels, materialistically and spiritually. And you say, "Well, if I, Craig, follow this, sell my possessions and give to the needy, I might be poor." What happens when we get poor materially? We become rich spiritually. Because when a person that is poor realizes they need Jesus, a poor person realizes they have to lean on Jesus Christ. They need God to get them through the everyday things. Now, I'm not talking about let's intentionally make ourselves poor, but if we look at all that we possess as God's, like the first church did in Acts, those that had ample sold houses and properties and met, there was not one needy person in God's church. How beautiful is that? And I just got to go off script myself and say how beautiful New Crossing Church is in this last year of the pandemic, when so many people tighten up and become tight-fisted, saying, "This is mine, I have to protect it. This, like the man in the parable, I need security, I need confidence, I need to know my retirement is certain." And yet you, the church, has been so generous in meeting, and you're giving riches to God when you give to the church and the ministries and the things the church does to help others. When you give to help a neighbor, a family member, that is giving riches towards God. And I love the church, the elders, we have a compassion fund, and in your keeping the church lights on and staff lights on, and the elders have actually taken the compassion fund of the church, all that's been poured into that, and by this end of the year, it will have been used for to help others, families during this pandemic that hit hard, especially many of the minority families and other churches. We've been blessed, other churches, we've blessed families in here. And I know you've gone up and beyond that. And that is the riches. That God's heart loves that. Amen. And so in this last section, I don't know if you noticed, three times the word treasure is mentioned in verse 21 and verse 32 and 34. And it's reminding us that Jesus is our ultimate treasure and he is the one we need. I've written in the front of my Bible a quote from Mother Teresa. And she said that you will never know Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have. And I remind myself of that because I know I have to guard my heart. It doesn't get better as you get older, all right? And so you try to live a life of generosity. And so instead of Mary Greedmas, we need to put Christ back in the center where it's Merry Christmas. We need a barn full of Christ, don't we? And I said I wasn't sure if there was a connection to the Christmas story this morning. You know, a stable is a type of barn in which animals are also kept in. And just as there's three times we see how important it is to ask yourself where your treasure is. In other words, what is in your heart? What is in the barn of your life, to put it that way? We also find in the Christmas story that three times the manger is mentioned. I only read to you the first two times. So now let's look at Luke 2 and finish our story this morning in 16 through 19. And the shepherds went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger, which was in some type of barn. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary did what? Treasured. There it is again. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. She was filling her barn with her son, the Messiah, the son of David, her Lord. And this is not the last time you read in Luke that she treasured what she heard, what she saw of Jesus Christ. So I'm going to close with a Christmas story that ties into this passage this morning. And, you know, and so Christmas is the celebration of the birth of Christ. And gift giving has become the custom. And I think it's a good one where we and our children learn to give gifts to others. It's so easy to turn into a mine, more kind of deal. But I still think it teaches to be generous. And the heart of Christmas is the amazing gift that God, in the giving of his only son, that whoever believes in him shall have eternal life. And you can't out, as the saying goes, I mean, it's cliche, but it's worth saying, you can't outgive the giver. Even Jesus, after his life, because Christmas is tied, he was born to die. And on the cross, he still was giving in a moment which we are taking from him. We are putting upon him, you know, pain and our sins, and he's taking that, and he's forgiving it, and he's putting it to an end. But even on the cross, one thief, he gives paradise. Even to Mary's mother, he looks at his mother and says, "Woman, behold, this is now your son," as he looks to John, one of his disciples, and he says to John, "Behold, this is now your mother." And he was giving up to the moment of his last breath, and he still gives today. I'm always reminded at Christmas time, I found it. It's Lee Strobel, who wrote The Case for Christ. Did you know he used to be an atheist? And I forgot that until I found this story from his book, The Case for Christmas. And so he's this great Christian writer, but he was a journalist for the Chicago Tribune. And he was given this assignment to report on the struggles of the impoverished in the inner city. And so which led him to a family that he did this article on. And he was, just like I said, just a devout atheist, not believing in God. And so not only is this story beautiful on giving, but it shows the power of when Christians give, it might lead someone to Christ. And he says in the book, he says the Delgados, the 60-year-old Perfecta, which is this grandmother, and her granddaughters, Lydia and Jenny, had been burned out of their roach-infested tenement and were now living in a tiny two-room apartment on the west side. And as I walked in, I couldn't believe how empty it was. There was no furniture, no rugs, nothing on the walls, only a small kitchen table and one handful of rice. That's it. They were virtually devoid of possessions. In fact, 11-year-old Lydia and 13-year-old Jenny owned only one short-sleeved dress each, plus one thin gray sweater between them. When they walked the half a mile to school through the biting cold, Lydia would wear the sweater for part of the distance and then hand it over to her shivering sister, who would wear it the rest of the way. But despite their poverty and the painful arthritis that kept Perfecta from working, she still talked confidently about her faith in Jesus. She was convinced he had not abandoned them. "I never sensed despair or self-pity in her home. Instead, there was a gentle feeling of hope and peace." You see, Perfecta had a barn full of Jesus. And he completed his article and wrote it and everything. But what's interesting is that after he wrote it and many, many people responded to it, he started thinking about this family again. And so he actually went back to visit. But he says, "I continued to wrestle with the irony of the situation. Here was a family that had nothing but faith and yet seemed happy, while I had everything I needed materially, but lacked faith. And inside, I felt as empty and barren as their apartment. And so he decided to visit them. And I guess a lot of people responded and gave generously because of, you know, being reading this in from a journalist. And but it wasn't the gifts that shocked Lee Strobel on when he visited this family. It was how they responded to all that giving, which was wise. And he goes on to conclude, as surprised as I was by this outpouring, which, you know, was bags of food and clothes and furniture and even money. Money was pouring in, right? And as I was surprised, I was even more astonished by what my visit was interpreting. Perfecta and her granddaughters were getting ready to give away as much of their newfound wealth. When I asked Perfecta why, she replied in halting English, "Our neighbors are still in need. We cannot have plenty while they have nothing. This is what Jesus would want us to do." That blew me away. If I had been in their position at the time in my life, I would have been hoarding everything. At least he's honest. I asked Perfecta what she thought about the generosity of the people who had sent all these goodies. And again, her response amazed me. "This is wonderful. This is very good," she said, gesturing to the largeness. "We did nothing to deserve this. It is a gift from God. But," she added, "it is not his greatest gift. No, we celebrate that tomorrow, and that is Jesus." To her, this child in the manger, he concludes, was the undeserved gift that meant everything, more than material possessions, more than comfort, more than security. And at that moment, something inside of me wanted desperately to know this Jesus, because in a sense, I saw him in Perfecta and her granddaughters. They had peace despite poverty, while I had anxiety despite plenty. They knew the joy of generosity, while I only knew the loneliness of ambition. They looked heavenward for hope, while I looked out for myself. They experienced the wonder of the spiritual, while I was shackled to the shallowness of the material. And something made me long for what they had, or more accurately, for the one they knew. So I'm going to pray, and I want to pray that our barns will be filled with Jesus Christ, that we can be like Perfecta, perfected in our faith, I guess I could say. And bow your heads and begin right with asking yourself, what is my perspective on life? Do I have a foolish way of thinking? How can I fill my barn with more of Christ? Because it's not just commandments that will change the heart. Only Jesus can do that. And we need to be filled with him before we can live out of a largeness of heart. And ask yourself specifically, maybe this week, this month, is the Lord asking me to be rich towards him by meeting the need of someone else? Our Father in heaven, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, first of all, with anguish of heart, we confess out any greed, the barn that we filled with self-seeking, more and more. And Lord, sometimes we slip into wrong perspectives. Help us remember, Jesus, that this life only matters as we are generous and rich towards God. And the only way we are rich towards God, Jesus, your Father in heaven, is by the way in which we are rich towards others in giving. Those are the treasures we bring with us into heaven that will never spoil, rust, or mold. We pray, let us be filled with you, Jesus. Let us treasure you in the heart as Mary did, as Perfecta did. And let us live out of that place and deposit, speak quietly by your Spirit. If there is someone, even now before the end of this year, that we could reach out to and bless, but certainly in the coming year, let us lead this way because you will always give more than we can give away. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand.